Hi everybody, this screencast is going to discuss biomolecules, and we're going to do an overview as well as talking about carbohydrates and lipids. So in one of our last screencasts, we talked about different kinds of atoms that are very commonly combined together in biology, and those are carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, phosphorus, and sulfur. And the four building blocks or biomolecules that we tend to see a lot of are carbohydrates, lipids, proteins, and nucleic acids. And we call these four different molecules, we call them the big four, or we call them biomolecules. So over the course of the next two screencasts, we're going to take a look at each of these four, and we're going to learn a few things about each one. So by the time you've finished watching this screencast and the one after it, you should be able to name the building blocks of each macromolecule, the locations that we might find each one and some examples, and then also what they do, so their functions. So each of the big four, carbs, lipids, proteins, and nucleic acids, are what we call organic molecules, meaning that they contain this atom right here, which is carbon, and they usually contain a lot of carbon atoms. So carbon is a really common element to have in lots of biomolecules because it's so good at bonding. This is because, you might remember from chemistry, it actually forms four bonds, and so it has four valence electrons, and it also has space to form new bonds. So if we were to add a hydrogen, which has one valence electron, to the outside like this, in four different places, we would actually form a compound that's called CH4. And that's also known as methane. So what we've just drawn here is methane gas, which is basically the gas that you produce when you fart. So if we wanted to diagram a fart, we could do this in a couple of different ways. We could use a dot diagram like we have on the left, or we could use a line diagram like what we have on the right. So on the right, we don't actually draw in the valence electrons. They're implied. We only draw in the atoms and the bonds. So methane is actually a pretty small molecule, and so we're going to show a slightly more complicated molecule to start our intro into carbohydrates. So here's a more complicated molecule, and you'll notice that it's actually structured around a six-sided ring in the center. So here's my six-sided ring right here. It's made up of five carbons and also an oxygen. And then on the top and bottom of that ring, if you imagine this ring is kind of facing this way, it's actually got some decorations that stick out from the tops of it like this, and then also a couple that stick out from the bottom like this. So go ahead and count the number of carbons, hydrogens, and oxygens that you have in this molecule right here. So if you counted correctly, you'll notice that you have 6 carbons, 12 hydrogens, and 6 oxygens. And you might recognize this chemical formula right here. This is actually the chemical formula for glucose, which is a really common form of sugar that you find in a lot of plants. So glucose is actually one of the carbohydrates that we're going to talk about today. But before we get into carbohydrates, I want to show you one more way that you can represent molecules. So this here is the same molecule on the left as we had earlier on the right. Every corner is a carbon unless it's otherwise specified. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 carbons. But this corner right here is not a carbon, it's actually an oxygen. And we can tell that because it says oxygen instead of just having a blank corner. So now on to carbohydrates. So there are 4 major classes of carbohydrates: monosaccharides, disaccharides, oligosaccharides, and polysaccharides. So notice that they all have this same suffix right here. And whenever you see this, this means sugar. And the prefix mono, di, oligo, or poly tells you a little bit about how many sugar chunks you have all bonded together. The two that we will spend the majority of time talking about in this class are monosaccharides and disaccharides. Monosaccharides are going to have one single simple sugar, whereas disaccharides will consist of 2 chunks of sugar bonded together. We're going to look at those in a second. So let's talk about monosaccharides. So these are also known as simple sugars, and one of the most common ones that you'll hear talked about in biology is our friend glucose. So just like we saw in the previous couple of slides, glucose is actually a hexagonal-shaped sugar. So it has this hexagonal structure, and then on top of it and on the bottom of each corner, you have different kinds of decorations, like this. The different kinds of atoms that are added onto the outside of the molecule we call functional groups. And the different kinds of functional groups that you add on to the outside of a molecule can make a huge difference in terms of what the molecule does and how it behaves. Another common monosaccharide is something called fructose, which also has a ring structure, but this is actually a pentagonal ring structure instead of a hexagonal ring structure. Fructose also has a series of functional groups added to the outside of its ring. I'm not going to go into details about exactly what these functional groups are because we're going to build these hands-on in class. So one of the most important things to remember as we move forwards is that these are actually going to be the building blocks of larger carbs. So when you assemble two monosaccharides together, you get what's called a disaccharide, and there are a couple that you're probably already familiar with. So these two disaccharides are sucrose and lactose, and sucrose is what you have in a sugar takeout. So now we're going to talk about disaccharides, which are another type of carbohydrate. So the two that you're probably most familiar with are sucrose and lactose. So sucrose is commonly known as table sugar, which is the white crystals that you might find in the kitchen. And then lactose is the sugar that's found in milk. And this is what you're allergic to if you're lactose intolerant. Now notice that both of these types of disaccharides, just like glucose and fructose, have the suffix -ose at the end. Ose is a common suffix indicating the presence of sugar. So now we're going to take two different monosaccharides and combine them into a new disaccharide. So at the bottom of the screen, we have a molecule of glucose and a molecule of fructose. However, when we combine the two of them, we're going to form a new molecule, which is going to be sucrose. So when we combine the two of them, like this, using a bond with an oxygen in the middle, we're going to get a new molecule, and this molecule is going to be sucrose. We'll be doing this hands-on in class later on this week. Polysaccharides have many, many chunks that are strung together, much larger than a disaccharide or a monosaccharide, but they are made of the same building blocks. Two polysaccharides that you may have heard of are chitin and cellulose. Chitin is often found in the exoskeletons of organisms such as insects. You also find it in the cell walls of some fungi. But this polysaccharide is what gives the outer part of a beetle its crunchy texture. Cellulose is a polysaccharide that's found in the cell walls of plants. While most herbivores can digest cellulose, humans can't, and this is why eating cellulose, especially beans, tends to make you fart. When you take a Beano pill, it gives you the enzymes that you need to more easily digest the cellulose and thus prevents you from becoming really gassy. Monosaccharides and disaccharides have a common function. Generally speaking, they're commonly used as fuel. The food that we eat contains a different kind of energy than what our cells need to use. And so we undergo a process called cellular respiration. And this is where we take energy from sugars and use it to recharge a rechargeable form of energy called ATP. ATP is the energy currency that our cells need to use. Unfortunately, we can't use the energy from our foods directly. We must undergo this process. But monosaccharides and disaccharides are both easy sources of fuel. This is why it's really helpful to eat a small snack right before you do a lot of exercise. Since this course doesn't delve too much into oligosaccharides, we're going to talk about polysaccharides. Rather than being fuel, polysaccharides are used mostly for structure. This is a molecule of cellulose, the molecule that's found in plant cell walls. Notice that it's made up of several of these simple sugars all stuck together. So 1, 2, 3, 4. You don't need to write down or memorize this structure, but you should know that polysaccharides are made up of many monosaccharides all strung together. Cellulose happens to be a pretty small monosaccharide. Now let's move on to the different kinds of lipids. There are three major classes of lipids, and they're all pretty different from one another. The one you're probably most familiar with is fats, but there are other kinds of lipids called phospholipids and steroids. all of them are hydrophobic, which means that they do not dissolve in water. And the reason that they don't dissolve in water is because they contain lots and lots of carbon and hydrogen. The first type of lipid that we're going to talk about are fats, the group that you're probably most familiar with, but you may be less familiar with its molecular structure. Fats are composed of a glycerol head attached to three fatty acid tails. Let's take a closer look at glycerol. So here you'll notice that there are three carbon atoms bonded together, and that on the bottom we have three OH groups, which are also called alcohol groups. These alcohol groups will become the attachment points for each of the three fatty acid tails, and we'll be constructing these in detail using our model kits in class. The process of attaching the fatty acid tails to the glycerol head is called dehydration synthesis, and it involves removing each one of these different groups down here and combining them with another hydrogen atom from the fatty acid tails. This produces three molecules of water and adheres the fatty acid tails to the glycerol head. Notice that once again, every carbon atom is always forming four bonds. Let's look at this fat a little bit more closely. So to orient you, this top part right here is the glycerol head, and then underneath it we have three fatty acid tails, 1, 2, and 3, and you'll notice that they have a lot of carbon and a lot of hydrogen in them, which is what makes this so difficult to dissolve in water. Notice if you look at the three fatty acid tails that the one on the left actually has a kink in the center. So right here. This makes the leftmost fatty acid tail different from the middle and the right-hand ones. The left fatty acid tail is what we call an unsaturated fat. It's called unsaturated because not every carbon is bound to the maximum number of hydrogens, and because it has a double bond in the center, it causes a kink in the middle of the fatty acid chain. Because of the kink in the unsaturated fatty acid tail, it's difficult for them to nestle closely together. Thus, they tend to be liquid at room temperature, whereas the other kinds of fatty acid tails, like the ones in the middle and on the right, are what we call saturated fatty acid tails, which tend to be solid at room temp. An unsaturated fat that you're probably familiar with is something like vegetable oil, and a saturated fat that you're probably familiar with would be something like butter. Butter tends to be solid at room temperature, whereas olive oil or vegetable oil tends to be liquid at room temperature. Both saturated and unsaturated fats are an excellent source of energy and fuel. Another important class of lipids is phospholipids, and these are very important in the cell membrane, which we're going to talk about later on in this course. But they consist of two components, a phosphorus head rather than a glycerol head, and then two fatty acid tails, one of which is usually unsaturated and one of which is usually saturated. Usually in this class, we'll represent phospholipids like this. In the cell, you have two layers of phospholipids that form a double membrane with a space in the center, right here. The outer layer is made of phosphate heads, and the inner layer is made up of lipids, which means that the outermost layer is permeable to water, whereas the inside layer is not. Because of its components, we call this the phospholipid bilayer, and it surrounds most of the cells in our bodies, as well as many of our organelles. The most important function of the phospholipids is that they allow the cell membrane to be selectively permeable, which means that certain things can pass through it, whereas other things cannot. The last class of lipids that we're going to talk about are steroids, although we're not going to talk too much about anabolic steroids, which are the kind that you probably are most familiar with. Steroids tend to have this basic structure, so three hexagonal rings and a pentagonal ring. Remember that each of the corners is a carbon unless specified otherwise. Because of all of these hydrogens and carbons, it's really difficult to make steroids dissolve in water. They tend to want to dissolve in substances like oil or fat. I've now modified this basic steroid to become something that you may be familiar with. This steroid is cholesterol. Now, cholesterol tends to get a bad rap because everyone associates it with heart disease, but it's actually a very important steroid to have in one's body. Among other things, cholesterol allows the cell membranes in your body to respond to changes in temperature and be appropriately soft or appropriately rigid. You also need a certain amount of cholesterol in your body in order to make vertebrate sex hormones like testosterone or estrogen. Okay, that pretty much wraps up carbohydrates and lipids for now, and I will see you all in class.